Welcome back to another episode of Unsung. Today we're talking with Shea Rhodes of Villanova University. And don't get mad at me because I'm going to mess up what you do. I always do. It's very complicated. People used to have simple things like blacksmith, you know.
Sure.
And you're a lawyer and you work with Villanova to champion writing things that are done against women.
Sure.
And what we're talking about mainly is human sex trafficking.
Correct.
So I haven't messed up yet, at least.
No, but, I'm the director and the co-founder of the Institute to Address Commercial Sexual Exploitation at Villanova Law.
And we've been trying to hook up forever because you've been busy and time has just been difficult as it gets, and we've got you up here, and I'm glad you're here. I learned about this through a couple different things, but it's something that it's one of those things. We have a lot of people on the show to talk about what I call unattractive social woes. There are things that people don't know about, so they don't exist. But once you see them, you can't unsee them.
Right.
And I think this is one of those things. And once I saw it and realized it was like when you buy a red car and you notice red cars everywhere.
Sure.
And it's one of those things we don't notice because I think it makes us feel less for not being able to do more about it. How did you get started with this?
Well, it's a complicated answer. I'll try to make it as succinct as I can. I'm a former prosecutor with the Philadelphia District Attorney's Office. And around 2009, 2010, we were beginning to develop and enhance the diversion court programs in Philadelphia County. And we started to look at what was a very small pilot program of women, all adult women, who were considered recidivists of the crime of prostitution or selling sex. And it was originally put together as a program to try to figure out why this particular population involved in the criminal justice system was just repeatedly getting arrested and convicted for a crime. Again, the crime of prostitution, and weren't being successful during their time of probation. Just were unable to finish probation and move forward with their lives. And it had started, as we were looking to enhance the diversion programs, a stack of 28 files landed on my desk representing these women and their criminal cases, many of whom had more than, you know, 8 to 10 convictions for that crime of prostitution, and why, you know, what was going on with them? Why weren't they being successful in moving outside and beyond the criminal justice system after being on probation? And we were able to formalize, and when I say we, I'm referring to myself as an assistant district attorney, the president judge of municipal court, Marcia Nyfield, a public defender, Mary DeFusco, who is still a career public defender in Philadelphia County, and representatives from the Adult Probation and Parole Department in Philadelphia County. And we formalized what is now a nationally known problem-solving or treatment court called Project Dawn, working specifically with these women and recognizing that where the criminal justice system was failing was they weren't getting treated for trauma. And every one of the women in the court program suffered from PTSD, from having been basically bought and sold for sex on the streets of Philadelphia, turning to drug usage, primarily heroin, but also crack cocaine as a way of coping with this severe trauma that they had experienced. And being in a diversion program type of court setting is really different for a prosecutor. You know, we have legal ethics, and in order to keep your license, you have to comply with the ethics, ethical standards. And as a prosecutor, the only time I had ever had an opportunity to speak to an individual that I was prosecuting was probably, you know, in violent crimes and shooting cases where you were sitting down with a detective and the person you were prosecuting and their lawyer in a proffer agreement, right? They were looking to give you information in order to get a better offer or a better deal. And in a problem solving court, you're really part of the team and you get to have, you know, direct communication with the women. And because of my relationship with Mary, who sits on the CSE Institute's advisory board, you know, her clients would call me directly and we would just talk. And I began to listen to them and was asking questions like, what is happening? Why are you doing this? And started to learn that in Philadelphia County, and now what we know is not exclusive to Philadelphia County, but the entire Commonwealth of Pennsylvania nationally, that a lot of these women had pimps. And, you know, from my legal education and interest in, you know, combating sexual violence, pimping is sex trafficking. And I realized at the time that we just had really not great laws in the Commonwealth to address the crime of sex trafficking or even labor trafficking. So when I left my position at the DA's office at the end of 2012, I began to advocate for what is now Pennsylvania's comprehensive human trafficking law. In Chapter 30 of the Crimes Code, we refer to it as Act 105. But it is only since September of 2014 that Pennsylvania has a clear definition in our crimes code of what sex trafficking is, and now also labor trafficking as well. But it was through talking with these women and just listening to them and, you know, what happens if they didn't comply with what their traffickers wanted. Not all of them had a pimp at the time, but at one point they were being pimped out. But the sexual violence and the sexual trauma doesn't just happen at the hands of the traffickers. I was kept hearing repeatedly about, and this is radio, so you can't see the air quotes, but bad dates, meaning individuals who were purchasing sex, the sex buyers, were a lot of times violent to them as well.
Is, now you said the word pimp, but can there be sex trafficking without someone acting in that capacity?
Yes.
But there's always somebody that's exploiting the person, either, even if it's a onefer.
Even if it, well,
you know.
Yes.
Okay.
So if we're talking about children,
okay.
Sex buyers can be investigated, arrested, and prosecuted as traffickers under both the federal law and our state law. And it's easier to prove because the elements of force, fraud, and coercion aren't necessary. There aren't elements of the crime if the victim is a child. So if we are talking about children who oftentimes, and I really dislike this term, but you hear about children who are engaging in survival sex, meaning it's very descriptive, that term, but they are engaging in sex acts in order to meet their basic survival needs. So someone who is purchasing a child for sex is obtaining that child for sex, or patronizing that child for sex, or soliciting that child for sex, might be even driving that child someplace in exchange for sex.
I can understand why you don't like that term. I think I understand what it means, but it sticks in your mind.
Yeah.
It's one of the reasons I think people avoid this, because it's just, you know, it's la, 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 la. It's too graphic. It's too close, because there's no way to sugarcoat what's happening.
Absolutely.
There's different degrees of, like anything, but what's a typical scenario, if there was a typical scenario, that somebody would get involved in this? You know, I'd imagine something happens where somebody runs away from home or something like that. Somebody Sure. goes from not having anything to do with any aspect of this or any other deviance or vices to getting sucked into this. What's a typical scenario?
If we're talking about child sex trafficking, a typical scenario And what I mean by child sex trafficking is the child is the victim of sex trafficking. Is a child might run away trying to escape a bad home situation, or might even just simply be angry with whomever her caretakers are, mom, dad, grandparents, and will might have even been recruited through social media, right? Social media is very prevalent in everyone's lives, specifically teenagers. And more often than not, I hear stories from survivors about how they met someone and he was very enamored and pursued her and was very, you know, loving and selling her the dream, so to speak. I love you. We'll be together. I'll take care of you. Oh, and by the way, we need some money, and begins to sell her for sex. And I say her as the victim, but absolutely boys are victims of sex trafficking as well. But that's the typical scenario. Getting back to the Project Dawn Court, all of the women were adults over the age of 18 in that court. And one of the themes that we see with adult sex trafficking victims is they report some type of victimization, sexual abuse, dating back to when they were a child. So running from a situation of sexual violence inside of a home is not an uncommon situation at all.
And this is, of course, grossly underreported because it's one of the crimes that the victims don't come forward readily.
Right. They're not identifying as a victim. I've heard survivors say that, you know, he was my boyfriend. I thought we were in love. I thought it was a domestic violence type of situation, and I had to prostitute for him to make money on the side. But I didn't recognize myself as being a sex trafficking victim.
It's amazing because no matter how much you learn, the more you learn, the more you know, and the worse it gets somehow. And I just – what I heard from that was somebody who was actually hoping to be upgraded to just domestic violence. You know, that was the upside of it. I was hoping for just that. And
yeah,
it went worse. The – what can people do to spot if this is going on, if – around them, near them, their neighborhood, their community? I told you the story about the person I heard out in a small town that noticed a bunch of young married couples, he thought, and realized after a while they came in and busted, and it was a bunch of sex trafficking going on.
Sure.
What can people look for, including looking for in their own loved ones before they would go? I guess nobody runs away to get involved in sex trafficking. They run away to become a star or a singer.
They're lured away.
And then they get pulled into this.
Sure.
So it's just this, it's at the onset, it's a similar, whatever you have to do to keep your kids under a watchful eye at home and everything.
Kids and young adults as well. Yeah.
The, how would you spot this going on near you? What signs are common in it?
I think it depends on where it is that you live. If you have commercial sex happening, you know, Pennsylvania is a really huge state and a very geographically different state as you move from the east to the west. You know, on the East Coast, we have Philadelphia and then southeastern Pennsylvania. We're a pretty urban, suburban area. And as you start to move out towards Harrisburg, it becomes incredibly rural. And then we're bookend on the western side of the state by Pittsburgh, which is another urban area. But what I say is that if you have commercial sex happening in your area, meaning, you know, strip clubs or feeder to sex trafficking, and there is a market for it, sex trafficking is going hand in hand with that. So signs to look for, if we're talking about child sex trafficking, it might be a younger girl or girls with a much older boyfriend. And he could also be working with what we refer to as a bottom or a bottom girl, someone who is also being forced to prostitute for her trafficker, who is allowed to recruit. And when I say allowed, it's she's forced to recruit for him. So it might look like there's a little bit of an older couple and then some teenage girls. For instance, there was a case a couple of years ago where a Pennsylvania state trooper stopped a car in Dauphin County and had recently been to a human trafficking training and recognized that there was, you know, an older man in the passenger seat. And when I say older, I'm saying 30s. a woman who was in her mid-20s driving the car, and he stopped the car because of an expired registration sticker.